Thank you very much for the invitation to give this presentation on the European strategy for particle physics. I know that the audience is a mixture of colleagues, physicists, or at least scientists involved in certain activities, and then also a strong representation by industry. So my slides are a little bit of a mixture. There are things that are for experts and things that are for non-experts. So I hope that at the end, everybody will be interested. So let me first remind you that the European strategy for particle physics is a process by which more or less every 6-7 years the European particle physics community updates the scientific roadmap and the scientific priorities of the fields. The strategy also makes a recommendation on other related activities like education, outreach, technology transfer, but also very importantly for this audience, relations with industry and also organizational governance aspects. The first European strategy ever was released in 2006, then it was updated for the first time in 2013, and now we have just updated it for the second time. The strategy is a bottom-up process which involves the community, the whole community. It's driven by physics, so of course the scientific input that come from current facilities like the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, but also others. And also the status of development of future projects in terms of understanding the physics motivation, the design of the facility, the technical feasibility, R&D work, etc. So the strategy is driven by physics. However, we do it with awareness of the financial and technical feasibility. So not just a crazy fantasy, but there is some realism in it. And I will emphasize this later on. The strategy produces a roadmap for Europe. So it's a strategy for the European community of particle physics at accelerator. However, we take into account the worldwide context of the field. And the reason being that particle physics today requires global coordination because there are so many open questions, as I will say later on, but very briefly. And of course, these questions require different approaches, different endeavors, and the number, the size, and the complexity of the project is large. So we cannot really, in terms of resources, also repeat or double some of them. We need to optimize the our experimental approach and our facility globally. And actually, over the past years, we have seen the gradual alignment of the European, the US, and the Japanese roadmap. The strategy is adopted by the CERN Council, which is the governing body of CERN, where representatives of the member states sit, and is the body that really decides as the ultimate decision power for all CERN matters. And just a few days ago, on the 19th of June, the CERN Council has decided unanimously and with very strong enthusiasm and support to update the strategy. This does not mean that the projects that are listed in the strategy or that are supported in the strategy, they are automatically approved, because individual projects, especially major projects that are financially substantial, require dedicated and separate approval by the Council. So the Council approves the scientific vision that is in the strategy, but not every individual project. I mentioned that the process is driven by the community, so it's a bottom-up process where everybody, in particular the young people, of course, who will then have to operate the facilities that will see the light in several years from now. So the community gets together usually, and for this round of the strategy, we had a very nice symposium, open symposium in Spain about 1 year ago. Of course, life and the world has changed a lot since then. I think today it will be impossible to have such a symposium attended in person, but it was very, very nice, attended by some 600 people. There were I think, 5 or 6 representatives from Portugal. Also some non-European representation, which again testifies to the interest also of the European strategy for the rest of the world. And we had many good discussions. And this community meeting has been the foundation then for the strategy document and the strategy recommendation. So actually, the scientific foundation of the current strategy is the discovery of the Higgs boson, which was announced essentially exactly 8 years on Saturday. And next Saturday will be 8 years from the announcement of the discovery of the Higgs boson, which was made on the 4th of July 2012, and then led to the Nobel Prize in Physics to Peter Higgs and François Englert, with the recognition in the motivation of the Swedish Academy of Science of the RHC and the ATLAS and CMS experiments that with the discovery of this particle made really a very important step forward in our understanding of fundamental physics. However, there are still many open questions in particle physics, which also have an impact on our understanding on how the universe works. The Higgs boson itself, well, after 8 years from its discovery, we know it pretty well, much better than 8 years ago. However, in the sense we know it pretty well, in the sense that we have measured its properties with increasing precision. However, it still remains a mysterious particle. In particular, it's a very special object. It's the most exotic elementary particle that we have ever discovered. It got very special properties. It's completely different from the other elementary particles that we have discovered so far. There are 17 of them, depending on how you count them. So these properties, which are called quantum numbers, are in physics, are different from the other particles. It also carries a different type of interaction from the expert in the audience know that the Higgs boson carries a Yukawa-type interaction as opposed to the gauge-type interaction of the fundamental forces. And so for its very special role, the role that he has in the history of the universe and in our own life, and for these special features, this particle can be really a door that allow us to understand what new physics may be out there. Because we know for the question listed here in this slide that there must be new physics, there must be new particles to answer some of the big mysteries today. And the Higgs boson can be a key, can be the way we get into this new physics. So it must be studied with the highest possible precision, a precision that goes beyond what the LHC and the high luminosity upgrade of the LHC can do. And the Higgs boson, unlike other things like dark matter, for instance, can only be studied at high energy colliders. There is no other experimental approach that can produce or can study the Higgs boson. In these slides, I've also listed other questions that are very, very important in today in physics today, not only for particle physics at accelerators, but also astroparticle physicists, nuclear physicists, etc. And they have to do, for instance, with the composition of the universe. We know that today that 25% of the universe is made of a kind of matter that we don't know, and for this reason we call it dark matter. We don't know the particles that constitute this dark matter. None of the particles that we know today can explain it. We don't know why our universe is made almost exclusively of matter with very, very little antimatter. We don't know where the antimatter went. At some point it disappeared in the history of the universe, and so on and so forth. So there are many open questions, and of course, physicists across various disciplines have developed different experimental approaches and technologies to address those questions, and more powerful colliders are one of them, and future colliders remain one of our main instruments, in particular the only instruments in the case of the Higgs boson. So, which accelerator after the Large Hadron Collider? There are various options that have been studying over the past years or decades even, where we have been doing design studies for the machines, study the physics potential of those facilities, and also develop the relevant technologies. There are essentially two concepts studied for a collider at CERN. One is a linear collider, which will collide positrons and electrons. It's called CLIC. And the other one is a circular collider, like the Large Hadron Collider, but with a much larger circumference, a factor of 3 larger. The Large Hadron Collider is a 27-kilometer ring. The future circular collider will be something like 100-kilometer ring, and will allow collision of electron beams and also proton beams. Now, the 2020 update of the strategy recommends to take the direction of circular colliders. Doesn't mean that the circular collider will be built, and if it is built, it will not be tomorrow. The strategy recommends that we undertake a feasibility study, because being such a big ring, of course, there are many challenges related even with the tunnel itself. There are, of course, some challenges related to a tunnel that cross Geneva Lake, so that goes under the lake. There are, of course, environmental aspects, there are geological aspects, so the tunnel itself is a big challenge. It's a big financial challenge as well, but also the accelerator themselves present new challenges in terms, for instance, of superconducting magnets, in terms of instrumentation, in terms of machine protection, etc. So it's a completely new territory. And so this is why I said the strategy is prudent and realistic, because the strategy doesn't say we should build the FCC. The strategy says we should start with a feasibility study. So it's a stepwise approach. If then the study is successful, then we can make another step and see if the project can be approved and on which time scale, with which money, etc. You can also notice that for both accelerator projects, the linear one and the circular one, there are competitors. There are competition actually from Asia. Japan is considering the possibility of building a linear A plus A minus collider, and China is considering the possibility of building a project, a facility very similar to FCC. So then the question is, why we should build it at CERN? Why should not Asia build such a collider? Well, because I believe, and I think I'm sure that my colleagues in the room or in the video attending this meeting remotely would agree that CERN and Europe should host such an ambitious project. First of all, because such a project has a very strong scientific case. So here we'll concentrate on FCC, perhaps because this is where the strategy tells us to go, the direction that the strategy gives us. So the scientific case is very strong in terms of possibility of understanding in all details how the behavior and the feature of the Higgs boson, as well as looking for new particles and new phenomena with a great jump in energy. Second, because Europe, with CERN and the European community, over the past 65 years since CERN was founded, has acquired a leading role in fundamental physics and in the cutting-edge technologies that our field develops. I don't need to mention the World Wide Web, the medical application that were discussed just before me, and many other impact and spin-off that our field has on society. And if we want to maintain this leading role in fundamental science and in the cutting-edge technologies in Europe and not give it to Asia, then I think we have to build such a future collider in Europe, in particular at CERN. And then last but not least, CERN has unique assets. And these assets are a very powerful infrastructure. CERN has cryogenic infrastructure, big workshop, an accelerator complex that includes not only the Large Hadron Collider, but also all the upstream chain of injectors, and the LHC itself will become most likely the injector into the future collider. And this infrastructure, you don't build it in just a few days, or if not even a few years, it requires decades of work. And also, CERN has the outstanding expertise of its personnel, including not only CERN employees, but also the European community, people coming from institutes like LEAP and many others in Europe, that have developed over the decades this expertise that, again, you cannot just build in a few years. Then CERN has another important asset, unlike some project in the US, that it has the commitment, the long-term commitment of the member states. And this budget stability and this long-term commitment is absolutely crucial to conceive, build, and successfully operate projects that have that requires decades from first ideas until completion of the operation, like the DLHC 50-year project, and the future project will be even longer. And last but not least, CERN and its community have the mission and the tradition of open science and international cooperation. And this comes from our founding convention. CERN founding convention mentioned explicitly, even if it was written in 1953, already at the time, people were thinking of open science. It was not called open science, but the convention says all the results, all the developments that CERN will do belongs to everybody, to humanity, and they have to be shared for free. And then also this, the mission of fostering peaceful collaboration across borders through science. And again, this culture is not something that you build in just a few years. You need decades of working together and developing this way of interacting. And for me, these are absolutely essential prerequisite for a large global project like a future circular collider or like a future big linear collider. So I have now three slides where I've summarized the main recommendation, not all of them, but just a few of them that to which I would like to draw the attention of the audience, my colleagues, physicists, who I'm sure know the strategy by heart by now, but also the representative of industry. So the first slide shows three very important general recommendations. One says that Europe, through CERN, as world leadership in accelerator-based particle physics and related technologies. This is what I was saying before. The future of the field in Europe and beyond depends on the continuing ability of CERN and its community to realize compelling scientific projects. And this strategy update, so the strategy that has been updated by the Council, should be implemented to ensure Europe's continued scientific and technological leadership. So this is what I was saying in the slide before. Then the strategy also praises the European organizational model, which is a very healthy and fruitful ecosystem, bringing together CERN and research centers in Europe, including laboratories, institutes like LEAP, universities, etc., in the member states and associated member states. And this unique ecosystem is really a strong asset of Europe. For instance, the US and Asia do not have. And so the strategy recommends that this ecosystem is further strengthened and we continue to we expand our collaboration. And then last but not least, what I was saying before, particle physics is global. These facilities are so complex, so expensive also, that they cannot be just carried out by one region, Europe or Asia or the US, but they require the strong collaboration of all the worldwide partners and also a collaboration with neighboring fields like nuclear physics and astroparticle physics. This second slide on the main recommendation summarizes the main scientific recommendation. And the recommendation number one is, of course, the successful completion of the LHC project through, in particular, the implementation of the high luminosity upgrade of the LHC. And I'm sure that we have discussed this earlier today. This is what we are doing now, and it should be a success. Until now, the LHC has been extremely successful, but we should continue until the end of the project. Then the strategy says that an electron positron machine that will produce millions of X boson is the highest priority facility just after the Large Hadron Collider. Whereas for the longer term, the European particle physics community should have the ambition to operate a proton-proton collider at the highest achievable energies. So the FCC proton-proton collider is the recommendation of the strategy. In order to accomplish this goal, we have to do two things. First of all, to ramp up the accelerator research and development efforts, in particular for high-field superconducting magnets, but not only. Of course, high-field superconducting magnets are the backbone of any hadron collider, and we have to develop new materials, new generation magnets. So there is a full field now of new technologies that have also large impact on society and on industry that open up in this way. And then we, as I mentioned before, the strategy tells us to investigate the technical and financial feasibility of a circular hadron collider with any plus or minus Higgs and electroweak factory as a possible first stage. And this feasibility study should be completed by the next update of the strategy, which will take place on the timescale of 2026 or so. Feasibility study means the tunnel, and also the main technologies for the two machines, E plus, E minus, and hadron colliders. And then the strategy also supports other scientific activities. So scientific projects that are complementary to colliders, I think not the previous talk, but the one before mentioned physics beyond colliders. So other projects that are complementary to high energy physics collider, theory, neutrino physics, detector R&D, software and computing development. And then my last slides on the main recommendation has to do with some statements and recommendations that are related to the impact on society. There is strong support to open science. As I mentioned, this one of CERN core mission. CERN has been, and the CERN community, when I say CERN, I don't mean the CERN laboratory itself, but the full community, the full European community, and even beyond Europe, that works at CERN. So all of my colleagues in the attending this conference. So CERN has been pioneering open science. We publish our articles in Open Science Journal. We develop open source software. We develop open hardware that for which we put license on the on our platform, and they are available to everyone. Then another important topic is the environment. It's very important nowadays. Of course, when we built the previous facilities, the environmental problems were not so acute as today, also because humanity was more respectful of the environment. But nowadays, every project, every endeavor, no matter in which field, must minimize the impact on the environment. So in the case of particle physics, we must minimize the impact of our facilities on the environment in terms of emissions, in terms of noise, in terms of energy consumption, the possibility of reusing energy, for instance, etc. Another important topic is, of course, the training and education of the young generation, which our field, of course, is committed to, but we have to do more to recognize their work. We have to do more to prepare their future, not only in particle physics, but also outside, because actually only typically 10% of the young people that we train in our field and that do their thesis in particle physics, only 10% remain in research in particle physics. The other 90% go somewhere else, and 50% of them go to the private sector. So we have the duty to create a pool of talents, not only for particle physics, but also for industry. Then knowledge transfer to society, where the strategy says that the particle physics community should engage more with industry to facilitate knowledge transfer and technological development, and then also support to public engagement, to communication, to outreach, to sharing with the public what we do. So the engage with industry brings me to now to discuss another topic that may be of interest to people from industry attending this event. And I would like to say a few words on how we are doing business at CERN, and how industry could do business with us. There are two main directions. The first one is through procurement. As you can see from this graph, every year CERN adjudicates contracts for some 500 million Swiss francs, which is about 50% of the CERN annual budget, to high-tech European, mainly European industry. You see the devolution of this contracts that every year we adjudicate. You can look at the total, which is the blue curve. You see a peak in 2024-2025 when the procurement reach an annual volume, financial volume, 1 billion to European industry. And this is because this was the time where we were building the LHC experiments, and so clearly the LHC accelerator. So clearly you see a big expenditure. But even away from construction of a big facility, you see that we are around 500 million Swiss franc or 600 million Swiss franc a year. Here you can see a summary. A similar slides was shown by a previous speaker. So a summary of the high-tech fields where the CERN needs to buy. It goes from information technology, from software, computing systems, servers, personal equipment, to civil engineering. We have massive civil engineering work at the moment for iLuminosity LHC. In the future, for a circular collider, you can imagine excavating 100 kilometers of tunnel. Electronics, pushed and advanced electronics, cryogenic, vacuum, etc., machining of new material, etc. So you can see that it is a really a broad spectrum of technologies and different fields, and I'm sure that many industry in Portugal, where already we have, of course, we collaborate significantly, but I'm sure that there will be future opportunities also for industries in Portugal. Here you can see the results of a survey that CERN carried out a couple of years ago with some 700 suppliers in 33 countries. And you see the results of the survey, where you see that the industry value very much the collaboration with CERN. Not so much, or not only, I will say, because of the financial return, but even more so, because collaborating with CERN is a way of companies, is a way of evolving, of growing, of opening new markets. And also because the CERN stamp, the CERN brand, is a kind of important brand in the CV of companies, because of course, CERN requirements are sometimes very, very often very strict. They require, we require high technologies, we have very stringent requirements. And so industry that are able to match and to meet those requirements, then, you know, putting this experience and this accomplishment in their CV becomes a kind of brand for then for opening their markets and for other clients. So this is the kind of feedback that we have. I must also say that very often industry and CERN work in a relationship which is not just client and the producer, the provider. It's more a working together, evolving together. Sometimes industry comes on site to build with us some prototypes, and then when all the challenges have been tackled, then the industry builds the equipment and those objects. So it's more than just a relation provider and client. It's really a developing something high-tech together. The other way through which industry can collaborate with CERN is via knowledge transfer. CERN has put in place a dedicated group in order to maximize the dissemination of our technologies and our impact on society, and also to show also to governments that it's very important to invest in fundamental research, not only because fundamental research allows us to understand how the universe works, which is of course also interesting, but also because fundamental research is a driver of innovation and so can have a huge impact on society. So this figure shows the three main pillars of the three main instruments that we need to develop to do our research at CERN. These are particle accelerators, particle detectors, and computing infrastructure. Here on the left, you can see the broad range of technologies that we have to develop, from cryogenic to vacuum to electronics, metrology, etc. And on the right side, you can see here the applications of some of the domains in which our technologies find application more broadly in society. CERN has also about 10 business incubation centers. It's a nice network. We don't have one in Portugal. Perhaps it would be good to have one in the future. These business incubation centers are platforms where certain technologies are placed at the disposal of, in particular, startup, so young entrepreneur who decides to use one of these technologies for some purposes. And as of today, we have 33 startups that are based on our technologies and which were born through the BIC. Before concluding, a couple of words on the relationship between Portugal and CERN. I think Mario has already discussed this, but let me tell you that from my perspective, the perspective of CERN Director General, this partnership has been extremely fruitful and very useful both ways. I think it's been very useful for Portugal, but also for CERN. You know that Portugal joined CERN as a member state in the late 80s, and today we have some 200 scientists involved in CERN activity, including CERN employees of Portuguese nationality or user coming from Portugal. And what has been extremely helpful for the development of the discipline in the field in Portugal has been the creation of LIP, which actually is a kind of model that we very often show to other member state countries, because LIP has been very useful in fostering the collaboration with CERN, and also making sure that the financial contribution of Portugal to CERN through the membership fees and the contribution to the budget could really have a big benefit in the growth of the community at home. And so thanks to this strong to LIP and this strong partnership, Portugal could contribute in a very important way to the LHC experiments and other projects at CERN. Is a very strong partner also on the computing grid, has a very strong participation in R&D program with many, in particular application, in particular in the medical field, as you have seen. But also Portugal was very strong partner and could benefit a lot from our training and education program, in particular through the engineering training program that brings to CERN many technicians and engineers and that are trained and then go back to, you know, academia or research in Portugal or to industry. I don't want to go into details, but these are examples of high-tech contribution that Portuguese Institute have made to the ATLAS and the CMS experiment, competing with other institutes on the worldwide scale, and being strong also in the data analysis and the physics exploitation of these facilities. So let me conclude now by saying a couple of things. First of all, my view of the strategy. I believe that the updated European strategy is visionary and ambitious, but at the same time is also realistic and prudent. And this is the correct way to go, to do things, to be ambitious, but also being able to address this ambitious in a stepwise approach and with a realistic attitude. I believe it lays the foundation for a bright future for particle physics at CERN and in Europe within the global context, and will allow Europe to maintain for decades until the end of the century, at least, its leading role in particle physics and in the related cutting edge technologies. So I hope that for my colleagues, physicists, engineers, technicians across Europe, in particular now in Portugal, because we are discussing this in the Portuguese environment, also felt energized by this strategy, also felt reconforted in their enthusiasm, in particular the young people. And I think it will also provide great opportunities for the economies of the member states and their industry. And so I hope that also the Portuguese industry will collaborate and will be on board. Let me conclude with the words of someone that you consider, that you know very well, and that we all consider like a model for all of us, and beyond even Portugal. It's an inspiration for a generation of physicists across Europe, and a great friend of CERN. And this is José Mariano Gago, who, you know, was Minister for Science, Technology and Higher Education of Portugal, and he happened to be minister at the time where the first European strategy for particle physics ever was approved by the CERN Council. And this happened during a particular special session of the CERN Council that was in Lisbon in July 2006. And so the session was attended, was even chaired by Jose Mariano Gago. And I would like to share with you very, very nice work that Jose Mariano said on that occasion. He said, the next accelerator and the next focus for particle physics research must be in Europe. That is the only way to ensure that the best people throughout the world continue to come to Europe. If, for whatever variety of reasons, we dismantle or connive in the dismantling of what we have achieved at CERN, no one will understand. Europe's capacity in the field of particle physics will be dead for many, many years to come, and the demise of particle physics would have serious consequences for European science as a whole. I can tell you that there are many of us in Europe who will never allow that to happen. So I think I cannot add anything more to those fantastic and inspiring words. And I think that Jose Mariano will be very happy of the updated strategy that Council just decided to approve a few weeks ago. Thank you very much.